Thank you, Eric. And thank you, audience, for your attendance today and your interest in this very exciting film. I, too, want to thank the World War I Museum, Park University, and the sponsors for bringing this event to us today. I'm honored to have the opportunity to introduce you to Disturbing the Peace, a compelling documentary about human potential and the power of conviction. A couple of days ago, we showed this film at the Kauffman Center for the Performing Arts. In the audience, we had between 700 and 800 people. Perhaps some of you were there. Can I just see a show of hands? Wow. That is fantastic. So the format today will be different than the one we did there. That was the full length of the movie, which runs past 2 hours, and there was a panel discussion subsequent to the movie. Hopefully you found that discussion very engaging. The format today will be different from that. Because we have a more intimate setting, we will carve out time for dialogue with the audience. The format today is 5 film clips sequentially showing you the transcendence of a journey of consciousness. I'm sure you're going to enjoy that. So what I'd like to do now is turn to the people who are not only responsible for that film, but some of whom have participated in that film. I'd like to point out to Steve Apkon. Steve, would you want to come on stage? Marcina Hale, would you please come on stage? Steve is the director and producer of Disturbing the Peace. Marcina is co-producer. This critically acclaimed documentary represents Steve's directorial debut, and it's already won coveted awards both here in the United States and abroad. We have with us today 2 very special guests, Mohammed Oweda and Hien Alon. Gentlemen, would you please come forward? Mohammed is from East Jerusalem in the Palestinian territories. As a teenager, Mohammed participated in the first Intifada. He was incarcerated for his actions. Now, he's a social worker in East Jerusalem and an activist for peace, both at home and abroad. Shen is a co-founder of Combatants for Peace. He was an officer in the Israeli army and a signatory to a petition to not serve in the occupied territories. That petition was called Control.
The Courage to Refuse.
Courage to Refuse letter. That's a powerful thing to do. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving these folk a very, very warm Kansas City welcome. And now I'd like to call Stephen to the microphone to talk more about the film and the format that we'll follow.
Thank you so much, Vince. Thank you, Matt, and the World War I Museum and Memorial for having us here. To Park University, to great collaboration, Laura Welch, Mike Lundgren, to all of the sponsors that have welcomed us and made all of this possible this week. We began a community-wide conversation this weekend with women who gathered to talk and continued at the Kauffman Center here today, at schools tomorrow, and houses of worship in a number of other places. So thank you so much for having us. It is important to be here in this place, in this moment, at the World War I Museum, a place that remembers conflict, not to glorify it, but to say never again, to recognize the true costs of war. I loved, Matt, what you said about liberty and peace being your goal and desire here. The only way to really do this great mission is to begin to understand how it comes about in the first place, to transcend the duality of us and the other, to humanize and work against dehumanization, and again, to understand how it gets created in the first place, which always begins with narratives.
And so I'm going to tell you a little bit about Reconsider. At Reconsider, we ask two main questions. It's what kind of world do you want to live in, and what kind of life do you want to create? So it's the ability for us to understand and know that together, collectively, we're creating our world, and also take personal responsibility for it. And there's a place where the conversation is always really important, because in one way, we're in conversation with life all the time. We're in conversation with each other all the time, in conversations with our partners all the time. And so a part of what we really want to do is open conversations and begin to be able to talk about everything.
And that curiosity that Marcina talks about is really to first look back at the narratives that we grow into, that we're born into and that we grow up into. And if we can have the first clip, we're going to show you a series of clips that take you through the journey of a group of people, a group of Israeli soldiers and Palestinian fighters that were born into a centuries-old conflict with a great history behind
it. My story begins with my grandfather, my father's father. He was born in Poland. He was the crazy Zionist.
Brothers and sisters and parents and uncles and cousins and aunts and everybody, no one survived. Zionism actually saved my grandfather, and that's the reason that we have a family now.
על הקמת מדינה יהודית מארץ ישראל, היא מדינת ישראל.
Israel is really the only shelter in which Jewish people can live in security and not to be slaughtered, not to be massacred by the others.
Fighting for the only thing that they have in their possession.
بداية مشواري خلينا أقول بداية يعني مشوار عائلتي أو بداية مشوار الشعب الفلسطيني. إقامة دولة إسرائيل هي نكبة الفلسطينيين. في سنة 48 عائلتي كانت ساكنة في قرية من قرى فلسطين اسمها قرية القبيبة. العائلة تبعتي سكنت في القبيبة أجيال وراء أجيال. في 48 الجيش الإسرائيلي احتل معظم قرى 48. كل السكان اللي كانوا في القرية شردوا بما فيهم عائلتي وأهلي ما عدا جدي رفض إنه يشرد جراء هذا الحدث قتل في البيت تبعه اللي سكنوا في مخيم الدهيشة ولحد هذه اللحظة موجودة في المخيم
Hello. There you go. So you can see the first part that we're looking at is the area that we talk about, curiosity. It's our ability to suspend our judgments or our beliefs of what is happening and actually be curious about different narratives. The idea that everything makes sense, that if you were raised where they were raised and you were born where they were born and taught what they were taught, you'd believe what they believed. And so that was the first one. The next one we're going to go to is around awareness, and that's where we actually see our participation in it. It actually is a part of showing how we not just are aware of the narrative, but actually seeing how we're participating ourselves in it.
One of the Israeli members of Combatants for Peace, a guy named Avner Vishnitzer, who is now a professor of Ottoman history, so he studies the rise and the fall of the Ottoman Empire, among others. And he talks a lot about the societies that we grow up in. And he talks about the Israeli society, but I think it's something that we can think about in regards to our own as well and many others, which is this notion of the kind of mythology that we grow up in. And this sense that if we grow up in a mythology of needing to be the hero, what does that mean in terms of our participation in things, our worldview, but also in our need to create the villain? Because we understand from Hollywood films that you can't have a good guy without having a bad guy. You can't have the hero without having the villain. And how we grow in these narratives and then choose to take part and to become the heroes within our own stories. Second clip.
مغرم بأغاني ثورية فلسطينية فكنت أغلق الغرفة على نفسي وأسمعها لها على المسجل دائما كان عندي حلم أن أكون مقاتل في صفوف الثورة الفلسطينية يعني وأنه ألبس البدلة العسكرية الفلسطينية مع الكوفية وكان السلاح المعروف الكلاشينكوف وأكون جزء من الكفاح المسلح ضد الإحتلال طبعاً كنت أشوف على التلفزيون كمان اللي هي صور مروعة يعني بشعة لمجزرة صبر شتيل اللي حصلت ضد مخيمات لاجئين فلسطين في لبنان أنا كان عندي تعاطف هائل مع الناس هاي وكان عندي شعور قوي جداً بالانتقام كنت مستعد إنه أموت في سبيل هاي الأفكار
I joined the army when I was 18 years old. I went to a tank unit.
I was admitted into Serv Matkal, the most prestigious unit in the Israeli army. I was extremely proud. I knew my father was proud.
So in that clip, you can see, for example, the narratives that pull us in to the conflict. And if you notice the ages that it happens, it doesn't happen when we're older and so forth. It happens when we're in a very idealistic state. It's in a place where we are there because there's something that it feels good to us. It's not out of something that's negative, but it actually would make sense we would participate in it.
We've shared this film now and worked with veterans across the country, actually, across the world. And we often hear stories of their experiences in war and the process that they go through in terms of at times being thrown far enough outside of what they're doing to connect to the reality of that situation and the narratives that they're embedded in. And when those cracks happen in those stories, it's the beginning of a process of taking responsibility, not for their actions alone, but for the world that we all collectively have created.
היום הראשון של מבצע צבאי בעזה, שהתחיל ממטס מאוד גדול מעל החלק הדרומי של הרצועה, והפילו שם מאות טונות של ברזל. תוך כדי שאנחנו מדברים עם המטוסים ואומרים להם צאו לדרך, רשאי לתקוף. אני לא עסוק בשאלה מה קורה מאחורי המסך כביכול. אני אפילו לא חושב שאני הבנתי מה אנחנו תוקפים. אבל על הנקודה הקטנה הזאת של דרום עזה, התחברו תמונות נוראיות רבע שעה אחרי זה, שראינו בטלוויזיה במועדון. ומשהו בסטריליות, במרחק בין הייצוג הדיגיטלי הממוזג הזה לבין המציאות המדממת, נשבר.
كنت في احد الغرف اللي كانوا فيها اسرى كلهم مضوا 10 سنوات فما فوق يعني في المشاركه في العمل ضد الاحتلال. حضرنا فيلم عن الهولوكوست. بعتقد انه الفيلم كان شندلرز ليست. وكان يعني في الغرفه كلنا يعني انفعلنا عاطفيا وكلنا كنا نبكي يعني. وهذا وضع معقد لانه احنا بنحكي عن اباء واجداد الاسرائيليين اللي هو الشرطي السجان الاسرائيلي واحنا حسينا بتعاطف وتضامن هائل مع هدول الناس. كنت اصبحت اكثر انا منفتح يعني على انه استمع مع الاسرائيليين وصرت اقرا عبري، صرت افهم الصراع كمان من وجهات نظر مختلفه. فصرت احاول اشوف الصوره بشكل خارج السياق.
Part of that narrative is the third part, was actually we are finding that we are in relationship to it in its own creation. It's where we, the first part is where we understand that there is a story, but we actually don't know. We're just caught up in the story, and we're participating in it. And the next movement is we can understand that there is a story, that there is. And the next part is owning the, our participation in the story. So that we can begin to question.
كنت بطلع على وجوههم بسأل نفسي مين اللي قتل أصدقائي.
I'm looking at those whose role was to fall when I shoot. The enemy. They felt that they could kill me without blinking.
كان بدي أكلهم. مش طايقتهم. إيش يعني هدولا؟ هم قتلوني وقتلوا عيلتي وقتلوا قرايبنا.
بس تطلع في وجوههم وفي يعني في لغات الجسد تبعتهم، هذا بيرجع لك كل المنظر اللي بصير معك مع الجندي الإسرائيلي اللابس عسكري وسلاح.
The first step for healing and the first step to build trust is to confess.
قررنا نتبادل القصة الشخصية، ولكن كيف ممكن أثق فيهم وأحكي لهم إيش عملت؟
Would I say the name of the village where I demolished the house? Somebody here in the room might be from that village, and then he or she will say, you've demolished my sister's house, or I was living there.
لما بحكي إني أنا يعني هجمت عثين إسرائيليين، راح أشوف بعيونهم للإسرائيل جالسين يعني نوع من التوتر.
כשסיימתי לספר את הסיפור, הם באו ולחצו לי את היד עם איזה רגשות מאוד מורכבים, אבל באמת ניסיון לומר לי, לא קל לנו, אבל טוב שאתה איתנו. אני מאוד הופתעתי.
We find that we actually have something in common. That willingness to kill people you don't know.
شعرت انه احنا والاسرائيليين الجهتين بنعيش معاناه نتاج الاحتلال.
لقينا انه في اندماج، انه احنا اسرائيليين فلسطينيين بس بنحمل نفس الرساله، بدنا سلام.
It was destabilizing. It got me thinking about so many different things, things that I never really thought about. I started to think about everything from the other side. All these heroic operations I read about when I was a child. How did they seem from the other side?
في طريق العودة إلى بيتك بوقفك حاج إسرائيلي وبتشوف إسرائيلي آخر بشبههم بالشكل وباللغة، فأنت يعني تدخل في تناقضات هائلة يعني في نفس اليوم.
פתאום אני יכולה להסתכל בהרבה יותר חמלה במקומות האלה ובהרבה יותר אמפתיה. אני מבינה שאם אני הייתי בנעליים שלו, אני חושבת שהייתי מתנהגת אותו דבר.
It is indispensable for a fighting system to deny the humanity of the other side. Otherwise, how can you possibly kill somebody? He has family, you know? He has hopes, he has fears, he has dreams. No, he has to remain there somewhat vague. He has to remain a target. Not a person, not a human being.
إيش جديد انولد في الساحة الصراع الفلسطيني الإسرائيلي؟ وبال 2006 كنا متفاهمين إنه نعمل كمجموعة مشتركة من أجل إنهاء الاحتلال وتحقيق سلام حقيقي بين الشعبين. وسمينا أنفسنا مقاتلون من أجل السلام.
So if we can hold up
on the last clip, if we can hold up on the last clip, that'd be great. So and we've thrown a lot at the museum here in terms of these technical pieces and clips, and really appreciate them jumping in at the last minute to do this. I just want to set up that last clip for you for a moment in reverse order, sort of giving you the joke after you heard the punchline. But the film, as I said, is about a group of Israeli soldiers and Palestinian fighters who were deeply engaged in armed conflict. And as we talked about, Marcina talked about this crack in the narrative, this understanding of actions being connected to consequences. That are far beyond the narratives that we imagined, all of a sudden got people to begin to question their own stories. And first, to confront their own narratives and then those within their own societies. And ultimately, to turn to nonviolence. And at one point, they were introduced to each other through a European journalist. And at the moment they agreed to meet each other, the fears began again. and all the stories. And what you saw was the first meeting of this group coming together to consider how they could create a third narrative.
Well, and the challenge that that brings, I mean, one thing that looks really easy to be able to just meet with another group of people, but it is incredibly, it's hard to depict how difficult it is to just step outside of our own comfort zone. And we talk about disturbing the peace. We talk about being able to really walk beyond your own your comfort zone. Okay, so the next clip, nope, you want to use your phone? The next clip that you're going to see, so the next part is that once you've stepped beyond that, once you've actually met, what do you do? The next part is imagining, so it's being able to, you've created something, now what are you going to create with it? Go ahead.
Now you can run the clip.
Thank you.
Each time we are creating this alternative to the reality, which is an Israeli and Palestinian communicating, taking an action together, it's a revolution, not less than that.
אני ארז מתל אביב, נולדתי במשפחה עם דעות ימניות. הערבים רוצים לזרוק אותנו לים, שהם לא באמת רוצים שלום, כולל הפלסטינים, שמבינים רק כוח. הייתי קצין בדרגת סרן בצבא הישראלי.
אני מנעלי, אגלבית הקאנו מסג'ין, פיה שוהדה. كانت اول مشاركه لي بالانتفاضه كنت عمري 16 سنه ابن 17 انسجنت انحبست 4 سنين
لما اجى وقت تجنيد رحت على وحده خاصه وكنت افتخر
one of the most significant things in combatants for peace is that we exemplify our possibility to change. And as long as we understand and respect what we were before, we can walk together that path towards a better future.
مسرح المضطهدين بنتوا فرصة للآخرين اللي عبروا عن رأيهم في التغيير عشان تيجي تشاركنا كيف احنا بدنا نغير الواقع اللي احنا بنعيشه
نحن لو عسيم تياترون بشغل يجروم لأناشيم لفو لتصخوك ولبدر אותם نحن عسيم تياترون
We use theater in order to rehearse the transformation of the reality. The reality wants to separate us apart and to keep the hostility and the hatred and the approach that each side is the victim and the other side is the perpetrator.
مش لازم نيجي احنا بتوقعات لا من الفلسطينيين والاسرائيليين انه احنا بموقف متساوي. انا يعني بتمنى يعني انه احنا نكون اقوى من الواقع المعقد اللي احنا عايشين فيه خاصه احنا الفلسطينيين ونطلع من موضوع الضحيه.
ام كل قبود للجدار وللتخلويات
ولا قبود للجدار.
في فعاليه وهي ضروريه جدا. انه في كل مدخل البلد تابع للسلطه الوطنيه الفلسطينيه وضع الاحتلال تحذيرات للاسرائيليين وكانه احنا قتله فيا ريت نعمل فعاليه على اساس على القليل نعدل المكتوب فيها وانه ما يحذرهم منا وانه احنا زيهم بالضبط
השאלה העיקרית שאני חושב שאנחנו צריכים לשאול היא איך אנחנו יוצרים אסטרטגיה יעילה למאבק לא אלים נגד הכיבוש.
So standing here in the World War I Memorial and Museum, I can't help but think about how important it is to memorialize not only those who lost their lives in war, those who served their country, but also to recognize that it is a monument for peace, as Matt began his remarks. You know, the generals of the US military went to Congress and demanded that we have an Institute for Peace, because they said, if we have to go to war, we've got to work toward peace. The Fellowship of Reconciliation is an organization that came out of World War I. And so it is as important to work toward peace, to challenge our narratives, even to challenge our nation when it's right to do so. And I'd like to end, if we can, Dave, with the last clip that we were going to do a little bit later, but if we can do that now and then begin the conversation, I think that would be great.
And I would just want to add, you know, that's one of my favorite parts there, because it's like this place where we're actually able to imagine something else, but it takes us coming together. And the beauty is the of it.
Last clip, please.
כבוגד בעיני הרבה אנשים שכן חשוב לך מהם, כמו המשפחה שלך או כמו חברים וחברות שלך.
We are patriots, but patriotism does not mean that we stand for everything our government does. On the contrary, I'm critical because I want to stay here in Israel and raise my children here.
קוראים לי סיוון חטיב, אני באתי מרמאללה ואני אנחנו ישראלים ופלסטינים קוראים ביחד לשני הצדדים לנהוג באומץ ובחוכמה לעצור מיד את המלחמה בגזה ולייצר הידברות רצינית באופן מיידי. אין פתרון צבאי לסכסוך שלנו.
השותפות בלוחמים לשלום לימדה אותנו ש-12 מיליון האנשים שחיים בין הנהר לים הם כולם שותפי גורל. המלחמה אינה גזירת הגורל הזה.
לא טילים מעזה, לא כיפת ברזל, לא F-16 ולא המרכבה שתביא את השלום. השלום צריך להיות ביטחון ועצמאות לשתי מדינות. בואו נחיה בשלום ובשלווה, שתי עמים במקום הזה. לא אנחנו נסלק אתכם מפה ולא גם אתם תצליחו. שתינו אנחנו צריכים להסתדר בארץ הזאת ולחיות שתי עמים ביחד. שלום וכבוד לכל העם. תודה רבה.
see it as a long distance run. And we will continue to go on with it.
لا يغير اللهم بقوم حتى يغيروا ما بأنفسهم. التغيير يبدأ بالشخص. ثم يؤثر يعني هاي الطاقة الإيجابية على الآخرين وعلى المحيط.
אנחנו מצליחים ביחד לקחת את הטרנספורמציה הזאת מהסיפור האישי ולהפוך אותה לטרנספורמציה של קהילה גדולה.
I think that we are an example of how these two people can live together, can create together, can disagree together. We are proof that it's doable.
ما ترضى على قادتكم. انتم تحدوا واخلقوا السلام بايديكم. سواء كان فلسطيني أو إسرائيلي انتو خلوا السلام غصب عنه.
أنا بفقدش الأمل في فكرة إن السلام إنه ما في حل غير السلام وما في طريق ثاني غير السلام.
Because it is people who make wars, it is people who can stop wars from happening. It's not the weather. We make it happen. And it is us that can put an end to it.
النراتيف ببلش من الرجل وزوجته لعيلته لحمولته لقريته لمدينته لدولته لدينه لقارته للعالم بأكمله حتى تصل للهيومانيتي للإنسانية. ولما نصل للنراتيف للهيومانيتي صدقني إنه راح تكون قضيتنا تحل بلمح البصر.
Marcina just mentioned to me, when people are willing to stand for peace, it's important to stand with them. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome back Vince and Mohammed and Khan from Combatants for Peace.
Watching the film clips in this format sort of contracts the intensity, but it expedites the evolution. Mm-hmm. And I think I just want to commend you guys for your courage, your bravery, and your willingness to come here 24 hours or more in flight to sit before you and share their experiences and stories. So please give them another round of applause. You know, one of the things that struck me when I saw that was when I think of people, I think of their ability to choose who they love and choose who they hate. When you think of governments, you never hear who they love, you only hear who they hate. And what I think Steve and Marcina have been able to do is to show us the demarcation between government and the needs and the will of the people. Can you guys just, from your standpoint, Marcina in particular, as someone who has combined the disciplines of media and psychotherapy, sort of speak to that consciousness that took you in that direction in the film?
Well, I do think it's a micro-macro, and I think that's one of the important things to actually hear from, you know, Hen and Mohammed, like that transformation period, because there's a place where we look at two countries and we look at them as two sides. But if you go into any area, there are multiple points of views, and there's the place to be able to transcend it just by being able to meet individuals. And so that is one of the things that we worked on, was break down the duality of it.
And Stephen, disturbing the peace, a curious title, and as an American, what was your motivation to travel halfway around the world to document the people engaged in this struggle and pursue this film as a documentary?
I think that this film was deeply personal for everybody involved in it for very different reasons, uniquely different reasons. And so I was very attracted to the region. I had a strong connection. I actually, as we're sitting here, I took off from, I grew up in Boston, and I took off on July 4th, 1976, our bicentennial. I took off on a plane, I was 14 years old, and we landed on July 5th, 1976. And as the plane landed, the pilot pointed out a plane on the runway that had just returned with all of the hostages from Entebbe. The airport, the streets were all celebrating, and that was where a very deep connection fused with me. But I was also very interested in the work that they do and what they represent as a model for all of us, outside of the region as well. What we could never have anticipated, and this project is now 4 years in the making, we could never have anticipated that it would be coming out at this moment, at this time, in this place. And the film actually had it's so deeply connected to the military and to veterans. And we premiered the film in New York City on Veterans Day. And the first screening we did was for U.S. veterans. I don't believe there were any World War I veterans there, but veterans of other wars. And the resonance of the film and the interest of the film on our part was both about the region, but also about these universal themes, about how we do get stuck in those narratives. And what is the way that we can transcend it? What is the way that we can begin to humanize not only the other, but ultimately it's a reflection of us? Because once we're past that sense of duality, it's bringing our own humanity back. And that's been so exciting to have these conversations around this country now, and the way that it's resonating in a very different way.
Mohammed and Shin, I've been extraordinarily impressed with your ability to dig within and search for your larger humanity, aside from what you've been socialized from early childhood trauma, to agree and believe and have reinforced is an enemy. How did this transformation come about? What was the trigger point in your development and experience?
Yeah. Okay, I will start. First of all, I'm excited to be here. World War One is important, I think, not only as another big war, but I was just listening to the opening and thinking about World War One, thinking about how many post-traumatic soldiers were there. And what can be the outcome of post-traumatic events such as this one? And I was thinking about Adolf Hitler was a post-traumatic soldier from that war. Yeah. So you can see where it can lead anyone after such an event. You're talking about childhood events. So when Steve was referring to Entebbe event in 1976, I was in first grade, and that was actually the first show that I've directed. I'm a theater director, and I was Yoni Netanyahu. In first grade, I was performing and directing a show because I wanted to be Yoni Netanyahu. Mm. That was my dream. So we grew up with this dream to become heroes. And as Avner says in the film, it takes a lot of courage and experience to realize that there are two different kind of heroism. One is the one in the battlefield, which is very difficult to become a hero there. But I think when you realize that it's more important and that you can influence more, not only on yourself and your surroundings, and as Mohammed is saying in the end, as if you want to be part of humanity, not only of your story or your personal story, family story, your people's story, if you want, if you are connected to your humanity and the big humanity, you have to find yourself the hero of humanity and not the hero of war. And it happened to me in a battlefield, but the understanding that I have to translate, you know, it happened to me in battlefield or in violent events, but the understanding that I have to transform the fear and the courage that I feel inside me into a civilian act was when I got back from reserve duty. Not when I was wearing my uniform.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I hope that it works. When you live the life of violence, when you live the life of violence, and you and your five brothers been in jail from 11 years old, 12 years old, 13 years old, 40 years old, and you're getting out from the jail, and when you all of your time is just living in one room with 30, 40 boys in the same room, and because there's a lot of children in jail, they opening camps near Be'er Sheva in the desert to get more prisoners. And when you get out from jail, you have two choices. One is to lose the faith and to go home, and this is the new life, and I will forget the last life or the past. The another, that you become your duty to defend and to work not to bring another children instead of you. Even if yours is his son, even he is your brother, even if he's your nephew, even if he's your neighborhood, even if he's a Palestinian, Muslim, Christian, Jewish, you don't care, you don't want anymore that someone live you the life that you lived and the way that your parents was moving from the north to the south to visit every month one of your brothers. So I think we are in combatant of peace. We choose the way of our duty to stop our children more and more to go to jail.
Yeah. You sign the courage to refuse letter, which means that you and the other officers and soldiers in the army would no longer serve in the occupied territories. Can you just share with the audience what that experience was like? How did it come about? How were you perceived? Where did you get your reinforcement, support, and courage for that?
Again, I mean, it was in 2002. I was already 10 years in reserve duty, and the narrative that you see in the beginning of the film, my grandfather, my father, the Holocaust, Zionism, as I see it as the only shelter for the Jewish people. All this was fuel that made me do 4 years in the army and 10 years in reserve duty, because I thought there is no other way. So I really believed, and all the arguments against, you know, because I had difficulties to do military work within a civilian population. But still I felt that, you know, I'm a tank officer, I became a major in the reserve duty, so everything was justified in a way that I could function as an officer. And then the first crack was a political one, not a personal one or emotional one or a conscientious one. It was when Arafat and Barak came from the summit of 2000 and they told both people there's no way to achieve peace. Both of the leaders, Arafat and Barak, said to their people, the other side is not a partner. And I knew in my head and in my heart that they are lying. that this is not true. Most of the people want peace. And I realize that this statement by them is going to make me an officer in the occupation for more 10 or 12 years. I had to continue reserve. And then I was thinking of my daughter who was, and I knew that I'm going to have more children, that I'm going to serve, if that we have no partner, it means that the occupation is going to last forever. So it means that my children are going to rule another people for next generations. And so I said, I mean, I can't live with this lie. This is a lie, and I'm not participating in producing this lie or maintaining this lie. So I decided to refuse. I returned from the reserve duty in April 2001, and I told my wife, it's the last time I'm doing this. Whatever the consequence will be, I'm willing to stay in jail for my life, but I'm not doing this anymore. And then after a few days, I heard many other people in university, in the theater, and just see people say, we're not doing this anymore. It happened in the middle of the Second Intifada. And we organized like, you know, a few nights. We wrote the letter, we signed the petition, we sent it to the Prime Minister, and the first petition was 50 people. After a week, we were 100. 2 weeks, we were 200. In a month, we were 400. The end of that year, 2000, we had 200 people sitting in jail for refusing to do that. So it was kind of an explosion of a generation who started the military, the army service in the First Intifada. And for 10 years, we were imposing the occupation until the eruption of the Second Intifada and the conclusion by our leaders that this is an everlasting situation. And we had to take responsibility.
Mm-hmm. So before I follow up and ask you the price you paid for that with friends, family, and others, I want to switch to Mohammed. And I'm going to ask the two of you to respond to that question. But the Combatants for Peace is a binational peace movement with Palestinians and Israelis. And one of the many things that you do is you give tours of the Palestinian territories.
Yes.
Can you share with this audience what life is like in the Palestinian territories, both in terms of physical conditions and the mindset of the people?
Okay. Just I want to say the first thing, combatants having 10 groups from the north to the south, and every group having her DNA. One of the professional groups is what they're making is the tours. It's beginning from the point that the first meeting between the Israeli and the Palestinian side is through the checkpoint. He's a kid 18 years old with his M16. He's ruling the life of the Palestinian. He's thinking that they are the terrorists and he's keeping them inside their villages because he want to make his villages safety. And they're thinking that he's the terrorist, that he's keeping them in the big jail. And from there, the point, and from there the story is beginning of hatred of the both sides and wishing to killing each other. So our main reason for the tourists is to show the Israeli that who's living behind the wall is not animals, and that it's not terrorists. People like you that they want to live, and I will show you how the life is there. Mm-hmm. So when you're taking the tours, buses from the Israeli and taking them to the Palestinian side, mostly it's near the settlement. The village is near the settlement. And you show them that the land had been taken, the water had been taken, the sheep had been killed, the trees had been cut, and there's no life. The villages around is having water once in a month. So they open the big pool like bear.
Well.
And they filling this when they open the time once in a month and using this. And it's amazing. When we were in the house of Yusri, they taking a shower, they putting this in the
bucket.
Bucket. They're using this for washing the clothes, mm-hmm. and which washing the clothes, they're using this to washing the floor and etc. Mm-hmm. because they don't have. But the next settlement that it's sitting on their land, they're having water and electricity 24 hours. Even it was two caravan, two
trailers.
Yes.
Yeah.
And you showing them that who's coming to live there from the Israeli side, from the Jewish side, he didn't come for because it's cheap or because it's the view or because it's better life for their children. Even in Silwan, when we're taking them, one of the tools that I make it in my village, that my village, we're having 3,000, almost 500 settlers. You showing him, when I was making the tour, there was a woman, it's coming back from the hospital, like his child still on her hand, and in the other hand, she having the M16 gun. So, which safety we speaking about, and which normal life, and which love, and which binational we speaking. So this is the life that we showing the Israeli side, and how much tours that we had made. Every time the Israeli side was shocked, because he don't know. He just hear from his media. Give me any story you want. Hear it from the media, in the Israeli side, you will find it upside down from the Palestinian. The same story, the same. You don't know where the truth is.
This reminds me.
After hearing Mohammed's comment, it reminds me of a quote by a historian who said that knowledge is not the enemy of ignorance, it is the illusion of knowledge. And what you have is this difference between the reality of the people and the narrative of the government.
Yes.
And when you or anyone in America, even in its short life, has this history, when you defy the government, the consequence is high, because it's designed to break your will. How have you guys been able to address that, given that a lot of people, in your case, Mohammed, would not support peace in the way you're going about it, and in the way that you're going about it? What's the price you've paid?
I'm always actually, I don't like to pay to talk about price, because it always sounds like whining, and it sounds like no. Seriously, I think I'm not. I don't. My existential feeling is I'm not paying any price. On the contrary, I won the biggest. You hear me?
Yeah.
I feel that by my transformation, I won the biggest reward I could have in my lifetime. You know. So it's not only that I feel that I gain my humanity back, or I got this prize of rehumanizing myself and connected to my real roots as a human being, as a Jew, as Israeli, as a father, as an artist, as an activist. So I feel that I belong to something which is bigger, and something that never crossed my mind, that I won an alternative family, alternative siblings, my Palestinian brothers and sisters, that I thought of them as an enemy, and today, not only Muhammad, he's not the nicest Palestinian, but others, you know, in the movement, in Combatants for Peace, I feel that it is an alternative family as a species, like a humankind family. We are, I feel that it's a kind of a human bubble. And I feel it here or everywhere we go in the world, when we are performing not only on stage, but as groups, or we are meeting, dialoguing with us in South Africa, in the Balkans, in North Ireland, in conflict zones. We feel that we are giving hope not only to the Israelis and the Palestinians, but to other people. But there is, if we are talking about price, I want to add that I don't feel that I'm paying a price, but I feel that sometimes my surrounding is paying the price for my beliefs, for my ideology, for my decisions. And I want to share with you one price that I feel right now, that I'm not paying it, but it's a consequence, maybe not a price, that my daughter, who is 18 years old, she grew up with Palestinians around her that are not monsters and not animals, and they are human beings, they are the friends of her parents. And she just recently, a few months ago, decided that she's not willing to be drafted to join the army. She refused to serve in the army, as she called it, refused to serve the occupation. And she decided to go to jail. She didn't want to lie to say she has a psychiatric problem or to see a doctor or a back problem or to declare that she's a religious Jew, because if she would have done that, she would be released from the army. She said, I want to go with my truth. I want to be truthful with myself and with the system. So she refused, and she's yesterday she was sentenced to, in the fifth time, to jail. After 76 days, yesterday she was sentenced to another 26 days in jail, and in 3 weeks she will complete 100 days in prison for refusing to dehumanize herself and the other.
Powerful. Very powerful. It's important to know, it's really important to know with Chen's daughter Tamar, and she's very clear about this, and she's very public about it, is, you know, as he said, she could have taken another way out. And she also is not declaring that she's a pacifist and doesn't want to defend her country. She is patriotic, she wants to live in her country, she wants her children to grow up in her country. I believe she would defend it from, you know, outside threats and all of that. She just feels that she is actually standing for her country in what she's doing, and that's a choice that people can make. And it's interesting, Vince, when you talk about price, because it's a question that often comes up. And I've now spent years with these guys, and I have to tell you that not only Chen's reticence to talk about any price, what I constantly hear and feel from them is how much their lives are enriched by each other, which Chen talks about. But there's something more than that. Mohammed, you talked the other day about the freedom that you feel in the context of a freedom march,
yeah,
marching with Israelis and Palestinians.
Yeah.
But even beyond that, what I see in you and what I see in all of the combatants is a freedom that very few of us get to experience. It's the freedom of being outside of what we so believe to be true that we're not even willing to step back from that and to see what's real. And they have a freedom outside of the narratives that have kept them and others imprisoned in a cycle of violence and hatred and separation from the other. And that is an extraordinary, extraordinary thing that you guys possess and that you hold for all of us.
You know, one of the things I'd also like to address is the political, because a lot of times we always are still looking for the villain. This film is based on not having a villain, if you can see. And you talked about, like, the normal movie has the hero and the villain, and that's what we're used to. And so we are wondering, if you create a movie and it doesn't have a villain, is it interesting? But there's a place where we always want to find the villain. Is it the politics? But really, when we're looking at politics, a lot of it is just a reflection of us, where we are in our current state, and the kinds of means and things that we are participating in and agreeing to mm-hmm. go along with.
Mm-hmm.
So when you hear these responses, you hear goodness. You hear goodness coming out of Shen. You hear goodness coming out of Muhammad. And we know oftentimes it is said that people who are considered good fight for their beliefs. Both of these men fought for their beliefs. And these were good men. So the question is, how does good versus good result in evil?
Oh. I think every one of us having the bad and the good, It depends how you will use it. I think everybody of us having black and white, good and bad. Sometimes the bad become more than the good than inside of you. And you don't know, and you think that is the good way. Even when you are revenging, you're thinking like you're making it the good way. Even if you're taking your freedom by force, you're thinking that it's a good way. If you will ask me when that day when we were in a violent way, we were so proud. And we always thinking that is was the good way. Even if you threw the cocktail molotov, you're using the clutching cough, even you use the stone, whatever you make, you were so proud. My people was going to the jail, and the jailer or the judge was saying for them, say that I am sorry, and I am taking from you 5 years. Just say sorry. And they were standing up and saying, no, I am proud about what I'm saying. And he was giving them more than 5 years. So you don't know what you did, or how you did, or the reasons that you make it, after. When you're sitting in the jail alone, you just have one thing, just the time. You just think and think, because this is the only thing that you have it, the time. And you think about the days and the life that's going like gone with the wind. Mm-hmm. Hundreds of thousands, 500,000 kids, instead to go to the colleges, they're sitting in the jail. And you should choose. Or you are Hamas, you are Fatah, or you are Jabha, or you are, and you are, and you are. You can't sit alone. So what's making you the Israeli army is taking you from silly guy, or one in 11, 20, 30. They're taking you, and they're making you soldier of one of this organization. Because if not, you will be lost in the jail. So this is the things that we take it from the jail when we went outside. We wanna take our freedom. We will not forgive up. We will forgive. We will not forget. But we will take it with non-violence way. Mm-hmm. So it's not saying that if I am going to non-violence way to take my freedom, it's saying that I am give up. But I think it's the more shortly way to the freedom.
It's interesting in hearing Muhammad talk, because I was thinking about two things. One is what's going on in the world today and in our country and everything else. And when we only accept our goodness and we don't look at the fullness of what our human expression is, that's when we always get stuck. Because what happens is the goodness gets projected onto the other, and we need to create the bad to feel good. And it's also, as you were talking, Vince, I was thinking about this question of good versus good, and it's not just good, but it's also when we believe we're right. And we are so intent on sustaining our rightness and fighting for our rightness that we forget even what we're fighting about. Mm-hmm. And so it is that process that we took you through with the clips and in the film. It is that process of transformation, of being curious and then aware of how the stories build, and then taking responsibility for those things. But it's the integration of the good and the bad. I think Muhammad says it beautifully. You know, and there's the scene in the film, which you actually saw here, where at the first meeting, it was the clip that ran before we set it up, and Avner says, you know, we found we had something in common, the willingness to kill people we don't know. I mean, to say that here in a museum that talks about what we've done to each other around the world. The willingness to kill people we don't know. Shifa, who was hours away from detonating herself as a suicide bomber, says, we realized we carried the same message, the desire for peace. The good and the bad that Muhammad's talking about, if you want to label them that way, because there's so much more of a human expression, is the integration of both of those things. And we have to recognize, here in a place like this, we have to recognize that we do have the capacity for violence and destruction, and we have the capacity for compassion and peace and love. And once we recognize that and integrate it, then we know we're making a choice.
Even Steve, it's more than willing. We believed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yani Shifa, when she went to suicide, she didn't will. She believed.
Right.
Yeah. When we went to the jail and we went time after time after time after time, we didn't will, we believed.
Right. Mm. Yeah, well said.
So our discussion here is centered on the Middle East conflict. Mm-hmm. But I think in many ways it can serve as a metaphor for other seemingly intractable conflicts around the world. And I'd like to turn to Steve and ask, what lessons can we in the United States learn from what we're witnessing here? Because I think we all would agree that we're at a juncture in our nation democracy mm-hmm. where we're discovering a new beginning, a different way of choosing to believe. Before, we had a source that we all collectively thought was authoritative in the dissemination of information. And now there are new rules being created. Mm. Can you respond to that?
Sure. You know, before there was a First World War, there were other wars that preceded it, obviously, and one of them was the Civil War here in the United States. And Abraham Lincoln said, Marcina talked about it before, if you were born where they were born and you were taught what they were taught, you'd believe what they believe. Those words hung on a poster of a parochial school in Northern Ireland where kids went every day during the Troubles and had to deal with all the violence in the streets. They apply to Israel, Palestine, they apply to conflicts all over the world, and they apply to us here. If you were born where they were born and you were taught what they were taught, you'd believe what they believe. We're so much more related to our stories than to the reality in front of us. So this film is about bridging cultural divides. It's about humanizing the other. It's about taking responsibility for the societies and the world that we are creating, that we are participating in and that we're perpetuating. And it's a model for how do we begin to do that process. So, you know, in this last election, the divides that we're experiencing now, they weren't created by any one person or any one moment. They were revealed. And now that they're revealed, we need to both take responsibility for it, but to see the opportunity. This is a tremendous opportunity. We're not red states and blue states. We're not white and black. We're not
left, right.
You know, left and right, even men and women, and all of the kinds of differences and separations we want to create. We have multiple identities. It's what when we were making the film very early in the process, we did a number of interviews with eight different people, four Israelis. Actually, we did with many more, but ultimately with eight. And I remember it was one of the earliest times we were together. We were interviewing Mohammed. And I remember at the end of this couple hours of process, and it's a very rigorous process because you're asking people to go to a very emotional level and to really talk about things that are painful. For Suli to talk about 10 and a half years in prison from the age of 14 and the acts that were committed that brought him there. Everybody had their stories. For Shifa, it was exhausting. We sat there with Mohammed after a particular session, and I remember asking him just to close his eyes for a minute and just to go to a deeper place and to think about what does it mean to be human in this world, and how do we think about things beyond borders, and what happens when you actually go out into space and you look back at the earth and you realize that we all live on this rock that floats in the universe. And I asked him to just open his eyes and say whatever came to him. And what came to him are the last words of the film. And I turned to the person next to me, to Andy, and I said, this is the end of the film. And everything else built to that place. And it's the same thing that we need to do. When you can move from layers and layers and layers of identity and understand that we share this one. First, we share this one country, our own communities, our own homes, actually, our communities, our states, our countries. We need to bridge those divides. We need to recognize our common humanity. And when you go even further out, recognize our humanity on this rock that floats in the universe. These stories that we get stuck in, these narratives we get stuck in that create the wars that we then need to remember and memorialize, make no sense.
And it's this place where we actually can own what we're creating. When we look at the movie, it's based in Palestine, Israel. And yet, what is United States' role in it? Right now, we had $38 billion was allocated to Israel. And if you look at what that money needs to be used for, it's to buy U.S. weapons. This is how we participate. We can look at them and say that they have the issue, but there's a lot that we're doing in our own country to perpetuate war. $13.6 trillion was spent on war this last year. So when we look at a world that is focused on peace, with so many people that are wanting peace, how is it that we're funding so much war? What are and then you show it in the movie, where are our values, our shared common goals, out of alignment with our actions? And it's in so many places right now. And so when we talk about disturbing the peace, we talk about taking those movements outside of our own comfort levels, when we know that we're participating in something that is out of alignment with what we want to see happen. And the question is, can we do it on a personal level? Can I look at somebody next to me who I might be challenged by who they are, and can I actually get to know them a little bit more? Can I suspend my judgment about you, and can I actually love you? I always say it's easy to love people that love you. Try loving somebody that hates you, or somebody that you just don't understand. And that's where our level of compassion and connection can really start to begin to grow.
I think it's convenient to talk about differences, and people with ill intentions can use that identity politics to ill will. What I'd like to ask Mohammed and Shen is, we have a feeling for what the differences are between Israelis and Palestinians, but what are your similarities? I mean, your history is extremely long.
The similarity between us is the problem, the narrative. And if you will sit with a Muslim or Palestinian, and you will sit with a Jewish Israeli, and ask him what this land for you, he will tell you the same. We were here. God gave us. We were before. Whatever you will ask him, will come with the same answer. And I think if you will look it for the religion way, this is the narrative that's sending us to kill each other. I think we should look it at the narrative of, like I said, the humanity narrative, that the both of us can live together. With all of the difficulties between us, we can. So if we will take it and we look at like the one side, that even if our beliefs inside, because of this I told you, I can forgive, but it don't mean that you can forget. You can forget that. I don't need you to forget that this is the land of God, and God give you and God give me. Keep it with you. But forgive yourself and me to live next to each other in peace, and freedom and liberty.
My answer is similar because we're similar.
Okay, I just got my cue that we're going to turn to the audience for questions, and there are microphones on either side of the aisle, so those of you who have questions, please step down. And while that is happening, I'm going to ask Steve and Marcina to address what are their plans for the film and where do they see it going from here.
And before you do that, let me say, if you're unable to walk down these stairs, I do have a roaming mic and I can come to you, but we would like to record them, and certainly this being part of your alternative family, we're really excited to be able to give you, I think we'll only have time for just a couple of questions. Steve Marcina.
So really quickly, the film is it premiered at the Jerusalem Film Festival this summer. A week later, it played in the West Bank with hundreds of Israelis and Palestinians gathered together under a full moon in star-filled sky to watch this film of joint suffering and possibility on the wall itself. Since then, it's played in festivals and theaters all over the world. We're traveling with it. And what's important are the conversations that are being created, which is why it's so important to be here today. And we'll continue to do that. The film will be released worldwide on Netflix in June, which also marks the 50th anniversary of the Six-Day War and the 50th anniversary of the occupation. We continue to travel and use the film to create these conversations and workshops and other things.
And I want to say, we did 21 screenings already in Israel, Palestine, actually more than that now. And when by the time we left, though, we had over doubled, well, about 30 more of them, and it continues to grow. So if anybody who wants to participate in having a screening, we really invite people to contact us and help and get this film around.
All right, our first question.
How can they get in touch with you to show their support?
Really quickly, disturbingthepeacefilm.com, and you could just give your email, or you could talk to us right after the screening, too.
And we'll say that again at the end of the questions.
Okay.
All right, first question, please.
Okay, so my question, I recently read a book by Maron Benvenisti, I believe is his name. He was deputy mayor of Jerusalem back in the 70s.
Mm-hmm.
He describes the destruction, the willful destruction of 4,500 villages, Palestinian villages, and the fact that much of Israel is built on stolen land. When I was in Israel last, that's not the narrative I heard. I heard that a lot of Palestinians just kind of left. They mm-hmm. just went to families' houses or something like that, but 20% of Israel is still Palestinians, and many of them have been displaced from their ancestral property. Eventually, this will come up in the peace negotiations. There's no way, it seems, to actually have peace in Israel without dealing with the property that has been taken. I mean, it'd be nice to say, okay, let's just have peace and not deal with anything that happened in the past, but the reparations issue is my curiosity. How can you truly have peace in a land where so much property has been stolen?
Well, we've had.
First, thank you for the question. I think you're touching on the heart problems and questions that we're dealing with, of course, but. We're not getting into, the details of the peace agreement. And of course, what you're saying is true. And we are working with this acknowledgement. I mean, first step is not to deal with how we are going to, the political solution and the division of the land and the territories, but the acknowledgement of the refugee problem and the suffer that the establishment of the Israeli state has caused the Palestinians and the responsibility that we take over it. And it's great that you've mentioned Meron Benvenisti because he's one of the Zionists who really consistent on thinking out of the box. And I think that what our message, regardless the political solution, whether it will be one state, two state, three states, zero state, I think it's less important at this stage, but to adopt something that Meron Benvenisti has adopted, which means that we shouldn't talk only about peace, but we should first talk about justice. And before we talk about peace, we have to talk about what it means to repair and to correct the injustice that that both sides made along the way, and how we can create new justice by not denying putting it under the carpet what happened in the past, but to be brave enough to acknowledge each other's suffer and to acknowledge the problems that most of the mainstream public opinion in Israel, mainly the Zionist discourse, is denying, and this is 1948. But I'm what is important in Mamanishti, in my view, is that to think out of the box, not to think in the zero-sum game anymore, not to think who is going to defeat the other in the peace negotiations, but on the contrary, to think how we can all achieve justice when we are going to struggle for peace. And there are new initiatives now that are not either two-state solution or one-state solution, and that's, I think, a beginning of a creative phase that Israelis and Palestinians are working together on these processes of how the vision of peace and justice. For example, I'll give you just one example that I think Baron Ben Benishti is one of its prophets, is that the new thing, the new initiative which called Two States, One Homeland. This is not either or, but a kind of a mixture, a combination of federation and of solving the refugee problem. Of course, when we get to Israelis and Palestinians, they say, this is so not doable right now. But when there is a will, we know that the solution will look like combatants for peace, mm-hmm. which means a community or a group of people, binational community of people that are both reconciling and dialoguing and rehumanizing each other at the same time by struggling against the oppression together.
I do hope some of you are tweeting out because there are such fabulous nuggets of wisdom that would be brilliant to be outside of this space and room as well. We have time actually for one more question, and that will be yours.
Hello, shalom. I wanted to ask you, please, Muhammad. So you talked about Palestinians that are really willing for peace, and your initiative is great. And I'm Israeli, and I serve in the Israeli army 3.5 years. And I wanted to ask you, Muhammad, do you really think that in the Palestinian street, in your villages, most of the people will say, yes, we do want peace? And do the Palestinian Authority will accept that? Or maybe they'll just, you know.
Okay. You believe in Roshi HaShabak Shelachem?
Do I believe?
איך אומרים ראשי השב"כ שלכם?
The head of the security services, the intelligence.
You believe in them?
Do I believe?
Yes.
Most of the time, yes.
The last five of them, the last in the 30 years, you believe in them?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the five of them said that there's willing in the Palestinian side for peace.
I do think that there is a willing in the Palestinian. I just wanted to ask you, what are the authorities' attitude toward those peace initiatives? I'm not talking about the people, because I know that there are in both sides people that want peace. Can I just say it in Hebrew?
אני מתכוונת. אם הרשות הפלסטינית כן היא תומכת בשלום.
כן, האם אני יכולה בתור פלסטינית להיות בטוחה וללכת ברחוב ולהגיד אני רוצה שלום עם ישראלים?
Let's say it in, I will give you this.
It's the most authentic experience you can have here in Kansas City.
I will give you so simple, okay? How many times you heard Abu Mazen is coming to the television, the Israeli television, and say, I want to make peace with you? How many times you hear that passes Israeli Jewish is coming to Ramallah and saying for him, and he's meeting for them, and he say, I am willing for peace? How many times you hear before 2 weeks in France, more than 80 countries came for peace, and all of them came, just Netanyahu didn't came? How many times you heard your president saying, I will go to peace for two states? So the willing and the wishing, and we saying, I think for the Palestinian side, you can hear it.
You can?
You can.
Mm-hmm.
But if you want to ask me about the right-wing authority that you have it,
mm-hmm.
that the Israeli side have it, you and me knowing that they are not yet ready for peace process or for even negotiation.
Okay, and when we talk about...
And if you can hear before 2 days that your Netanyahu, he signed about a new 5,000 homes in settlement in middle of the Palestinian area. So if you think that building 5,000 homes in the Palestinian area for a new settlement, this is the wishing and the willing for peace from the Israeli side, and this is the baddest of the Palestinian side, so I'm sorry to tell you that.
So what you're saying, actually, the beautiful part is this. As part of the alternative, as part of the alternative family, we certainly want to keep the conversation going. I know that there are more questions out in the audience as well, and we will continue the conversation after.
Can I say something
as well?
When we understand that it's not about the land, it's just about love and respect other people, and it's not always about the redness, then we will have peace.
One sentence. You ask Muhammad about the Palestinian Authority. The Palestinian Authority is hugging combatants for peace. Wherever we go in the world, we are being invited by the Palestinian ambassador. We've never been invited by the Israeli ambassador anywhere in the world, and the government consider combatants for peace as an embarrassment for the government.
Laura, if I can just very quickly say that this is a beautiful question to end with.
It is.
Because I have to say, we've now done screenings in Israel and in Palestine. We've done mixed screenings, but we've done screenings separately as well. And I assure you that exact question has been asked by young men and women standing in Ramallah, in Hebron, in Susia, in Kalkilia, in Nablus, same exact question.
Mm-hmm. And now right here in the heart of Kansas City, in the heart of America, two stories under a national war memorial. So it's a lovely thing.
I have to say something. Take me a minute. I saw the movie, I was impressed. Not like Muhammad and the Khan. I was humane since I was born. Yeah. I was never wars. I would never go to prison for one day because I don't think it's worth it. I'm not a man of principles. Examples that I took in my life was, which is the best country in the world to live in? Switzerland. Switzerland had three people, Italians, French, and Germans, never had war. But the one thing that if you keep talking about what Israelis do, if they did right or wrong, the question that the Israeli girl asked Muhammad is, and I'll put it simply, he can walk in Tel Aviv whenever he wants. I cannot walk in Nablus for 1 minute because I'll kill him.
I walk in Nablus every week.
You
want to join me, you can join me in Nablus.
No, I don't want to join you.
Why?
Because I want to walk by myself, like he can walk by himself. And my point is, it's not who's wrong and who's right. The Palestinians are 100% right, and so are the Israelis. But what I want to say to them, think like that. If the Jews forgave Germany, you can forgive everyone. We go to Germany, we live out of Germany, of Germans who killed his grandparents, Clint's grandparents, most of my family. And you're all too young for that. But in 1957, I left Israel for the first time. I went to school in England. On my passport, it said eligible for all the countries except Germany. 1957. 2017, Germany is the best friend of Israel. Yeah. Israelis live in Berlin and all that. If this can happen, anything can happen.
Yeah. Sure.
Thank you. Thank you. We're actually on our way to Berlin tomorrow.
And it is one of the beautiful things about this film is that we want to start these conversations. It is amazing the kinds of conversations that we're having everywhere we go.
Absolutely, and on behalf of the National World War I Museum and Memorial, it really is our pleasure to be hosting these conversations, that we can be crafting these narratives, that we can be finding that third story. And to close us out, I would like to reintroduce Associate Vice President of Park University, Eric Burkhardt.
And to be brief, thanks again, not only to all the sponsors who made this possible, thank you to all our participants. This was an engaging and powerful discussion. Please join me in thanking them. Uh, our friends and partners at the National World War One Museum and Memorial not only live stream this, but this is going to be available online. So if you want to go back online, visit worldwar1.org, that's right. And you'll be able to replay this time and time again. Please share that with your friends. We think this is a powerful discussion, and we hope that you join all of them in continuing the conversation. Good afternoon.
Thank you
so
much.
Thank you.